Hey there, Mr. Reddit here. Welcome back to another episode of r/EntitledParentStories. Our first story we'll be reading today. I kicked out my mother-in-law because she wants my husband to leave me. After that, Karen tries to force me to cover her shift, ends up losing her job. And after that, entitled parent wants refund on student's dining plan. Now for every thumbs up this video gets, one Karen has to spend the night in jail. Better than spending it with you, I'll tell you that much. So please smash that like button and subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. I kicked out my mother-in-law because she wants my husband to leave me. I'm 24, female, and my husband, who's 25, male, and I just had a beautiful baby girl 2 months ago. His mom is a self-made entrepreneur, and she's honestly an inspiration to me. She's strong, intelligent, had fought hard for everything she owns, and before I got pregnant, we got along just fine. She supported me in my professional decisions and never showed any sign to not approve of our relationship. When we told my husband's parents that we were pregnant, his dad congratulated us and looked so happy to be a grandfather. His mom, not so much. She quickly asked us what were we going to do and that if we didn't want to have the kid, she would support us. She believed that we both had promising futures and if we had a baby this early in our careers, we'll never fulfill our dreams. But my husband and I assured her that we had everything planned. We both agreed that I was going to dedicate a year to our daughter, and then I was going to go back to work. We never asked them for a penny, and neither of us waited for them to fund our new lifestyle. My mother-in-law didn't like it. My husband had a good job, had just enrolled himself on a master's degree, and now he's going to be a father and the breadwinner of the house. For her, it was too much on his shoulders. So a few days ago, she came to my house and proposed an experiment to me. She told me that during the rest of the year I was going to be a stay-at-home mom, I could go back to my parents. This will allow my husband to come home and rest after a long day of work or school, and during the weekends, he could come to me and visit us if he had the energy to do so. I said that it wasn't fair since she was our daughter and not just mine, and that she shouldn't expect my husband to not have any kind of responsibility towards her. She said that after I ruined my husband's life with an early baby, that's the least I could do. That I was going to grow comfortable after 1 year of doing basically nothing, and that if my husband was lucky, this would end on a divorce, which, for her, is the best outcome by now. I couldn't believe what she was proposing to me, and told her that she was crazy for even thinking that, and that our baby didn't appear magically in my belly. I kicked her out, and when my husband came home, I told him everything. We decided to cut contact with his mom. But I can't get the fact that she said I ruined his life out of my head. I'm not planning on being a stay-at-home mom forever, and to be honest, I do want to get back to work. I'm an architect while my husband is an engineer, and I very much enjoy my career. He does come home from work tired, but our baby isn't a big problem. She doesn't cry all the time, and we get her to calm down very easily. Also, it's not like I'm home doing nothing. I do small projects for my friend's firm every now and then as a freelancer, and I have a position waiting for me there. My husband and I just decided that I had to remain available for our daughter the first year, in case anything happens, because this is our first baby. Edit. Whoa, thank you for all of your input. I can't believe this blew up. My mother-in-law hasn't always been like this, but after we decided to have the baby, her behavior changed completely. I'll answer some of your questions you left. Again, thank you so much. Karen tries to force me to cover her shift, ends up losing her job. Okay, so I, female 21, work in a small and private liquid and tobacco store. We have a total of 10 workers. For most of them, it's their second job. Only I and three other coworkers only have this job. However, I'm a college student, so I'm not working many hours, usually only 10 hours a week. Last Friday morning, one of my coworkers, Alyssa, asked me if I could cover her shift. I declined because since I started working there 3 years ago, I'm constantly covering shifts for other people. However, when I ask for people to cover my shift or trade shifts, nobody returns the favor. So in the last 6 months, I started to decline as well, unless someone is actually sick or so. Alyssa said it's urgent, and since it was the Friday closing shift, I assumed she just wants to go partying since she's known to ask for covering her shifts on the weekend so she can go party. I suggested that she can ask some other coworker. She only said that nobody is willing to cover her shift, and I just said, "Sorry, but I can't." This conversation was exclusively via text message. Yesterday, when I came to work, my other coworker, Tara, she's kind of friends with Alyssa, at least at work, was upset. I asked her what was wrong, and she just said that I'm a selfish jerk, and then explained that Alyssa apparently wanted to have her shift covered because she was asked to come to some meeting with her boss at her main work, and since she missed it, she was fired. Apparently, she was on the verge of being fired before, and the meeting was to talk out stuff with her boss, and since she didn't come, she couldn't explain herself, and that sealed the deal for her boss. Coworker and I had a fight then. I told her that Alyssa didn't tell me why exactly she wanted her shift covered, and if I had known the exact reason, I probably would have done it. Tara said that Alyssa didn't need to give me the real reason, and the indicator that it's urgent should have been enough. When I said that Alyssa had said such things in the past just to go out partying, she just insisted that I just cannot assume that someone is lying when they say it's urgent. I asked Tara why she didn't cover the shift, and she just said that since she's working 40 hours a week, she needs every rest she can get, and basically said that since I'm just a college student, I shouldn't be so difficult about working a few more hours. I'm feeling really crappy about this. I know that I didn't know the real reason why she wanted her shift covered, but maybe I really should have just believed her when she said it was urgent. I don't know if I should talk to Alyssa and what to say to her. Am I the jerk? Edit. Didn't expect this to blow up overnight. First of all, thanks to all the nice comments telling me it's okay to say no. While I'm doing it, since I was completely overworked in the past, I still sometimes feel guilty about saying no. But somehow, it feels nice that people validate this. Secondly, a lot of you said that her story sounds fishy. I personally didn't question it at first because we sometimes have meetings with our boss after closing time, 9 p.m., as well at the store. But the more people commented, the more I started to doubt Alyssa's story as well. Her main work is in retail as well, so I assumed it was just a stay here after the shift thing. But she didn't bother to call our boss to say it's important. And again, some people say it's unusual to have such talks on Fridays, and it's also unusual to get told about such a meeting with basically no advance. Either Alyssa didn't care about the interview as much, or she lied about having it. I'm not sure, and to be honest, I'm not sure I want to know. I will just stand firm as you all have told me to do, and try not to let them guilt trip me. Entitled parent wants refund on student's dining plan. A few days ago, we had freshman orientation at the college where I work. I was in the dining hall when this particular event happened. Note that all meals were comped by the college this past week, so no one was paying for anything. Not students, not faculty or staff, not parents, except for the fancy stuff at the campus version of Starbucks, which is in the front of the dining hall. Mother comes in with her four kids. One is a new student on our campus. The other three are the younger siblings. Student shows her new ID card, which is all they've had to do this week to get into the dining hall for free. Entire family goes through. No one pays for anything. Not 5 minutes later, I hear raised voices near the table. I was sitting fairly close to the cash register in the coffee shop area. Mother and all four kids come back to the cash register, and the mother is yelling that she wants a refund because the only food in the dining hall is burgers and fries and chicken tenders and pizza. The cashier is trying to explain to her that she couldn't give her a refund since all of the meals were free that day, so she hadn't paid to begin with. And the woman says she wants a refund on her daughter's dining plan because the food isn't worth eating. Note that there is nowhere else nearby where her daughter can get meals. The nearest restaurants and grocery store are in the next town over, 15 miles away, and freshmen aren't allowed to have cars on our campus. So if the daughter doesn't have a meal plan with the dining hall, she's not going to be eating. This lady keeps yelling at the poor cashier, who finally calls her manager, who comes up and says the dining hall itself can't process refunds anyway, and they'd have to talk to campus administration about it. But he reiterated to her that if her daughter didn't have a meal plan, she'd have nowhere to get food. This lady looks at him and says, "Fine, we'll be going over to administration right now and unenrolling her from the classes here. She can't possibly go to school here with nothing to eat but burgers and pizza." The poor daughter was standing there looking absolutely devastated, and the other kids looked mortified. I honestly thought the student was going to start crying. No idea what happened after that, because they left the building, but oh my goodness, did I ever feel sorry for that poor girl. To be pulled out of college on her first day because her mother didn't like the food the dining hall served? And if they actually went through with it, I really hope they didn't, she won't be able to get into another school until January at the earliest. And if she was a scholarship student, a lot of our kids are, it may take a full year to be able to get a scholarship somewhere else. The really sad thing was, The very basic burgers and pizza menu the dining hall was running that day was only because meals were free and they were trying to save some money on it. They also knew it would be busy with the parents on campus, so they were making foods that are easy to prepare in mass quantities. Also, if they had stuck around long enough for dinner, they would have gotten much more fancier meal options. And starting Monday, there will also be a full salad bar and self-serve deli available at lunch and dinner. But since apparently baby girl was far too important to eat normal food like every other student on just about every other college campus out there, they're just going to make her go back home again. That poor, poor kid. And honestly, her poor three younger siblings too. I felt sorry for all of them. How not to recruit a nurse. In nursing school, you have clinical days. The day before clinical, you have to go to the hospital and pick a patient you'll work with the next day. You also have a chance to work as a CNA while in school to gain more experience and make a little money because it's difficult to work full-time and go through nursing school. There were two hospitals in my small town. I worked at Hospital A in the ICU as a CNA. My clinicals were in the larger hospital, Hospital B. I worked a day shift at my hospital and ran over to the other one across town to pick my patient and get my preclinical work done. It was about 30 minutes after 7 when I got there. Most hospital shifts you work are 12 hours, 7 to 7. I knew I was going to be on a med-surg floor, so I got on the elevator to ride up and looked through my paperwork to find out what unit I'd be at the next day. A lady in a pantsuit with a hospital badge was already on the elevator and gave me a look like I had peed in her Cheerios. Okay, I just moved to the side and finally found my paper letting me know what floor and unit I needed to go to. In a really ugly tone, the pantsuit asked, "Where are you headed?" Me, staying polite, "I'm headed to 3N. She slammed the button and just said, "Thank you." As we were riding, she turned to me and started chewing me out. "It's not appropriate for you to be coming in 20 minutes after shift change. We've been understaffed all day, and those units are slammed right now." I just kind of stared at her for a second and thought, I'm not going to be disturbing the nurses, and if I have to wait on a chart, that's fine. I don't intend on interrupting report, but I just said, okay. If anything, her face got angrier. My floor arrived, and she stepped out with me and kept pace with me as I headed to the nurse's station. I went to the side and took a look at the assignment board to see if anyone had a diagnosis I hadn't worked with before, then sat down out of the way and waited quietly because the charge nurses were still discussing assignments. When they finished, I'd ask the charge nurse if there was a patient I should pick. I do this because sometimes there were interesting procedures or I'd get a chance to practice my skills the next day. As I was waiting, pantsuit lady watched me, and when she saw me sit down, she immediately snapped her fingers at me and pointed down to the floor and said, "You come here." The voice was nasty enough that it stopped several people mid-report to find out what was going on. I stood up and approached her, and she grabbed my sleeve and pulled me over closer to the charge nurses. Ignoring me and talking directly to the charge nurses, she proceeded to tell them that I was their aide, and she wanted them to make sure I was written up for being late. I realized then that she thought I worked there. I was a lot less confrontational or aggressive then. My, how nursing changes you. But I never really got the chance to say anything as she jerked my hand away from me and wiped it like she had just touched doo-doo, looked at me with a face I can only describe as sour lemon smugness, and walked away. The charge looked at me and said, "We already have an aide, but sure could use you. Let me see how." She trailed off as I held out my hand and said, "I don't work here. I'm with my school, and I'm here to pick out a patient for clinicals tomorrow. Does that lady always treat people like they're dogs?" The charge nurse stared at me for a second and then started laughing and said, "Stupid jerk, don't mind her. We all hate her." She then asked, "How much longer do you have?" I replied that I graduate in 6 months. I also asked if they had any interesting procedures or if they had a patient that a one-to-one student nurse would make easier to handle. She also asked where I planned on working after I graduated. I just looked down the hallway where the pantsuit had gone and just said, "Well, not here," which made her laugh even more. I had a truly relaxing clinical the next day with a sweet elderly lady with dementia and a minor medical condition. We folded laundry together to keep her busy and to keep her from pulling at her surgical sites. What was really fun about it is that the next semester, when representatives came to try to recruit you to the hospital, I got to reply to a question about why I wasn't interested in their hospital. I got to say that I didn't appreciate the way they treated their staff and tell the story. There was recognition in their eyes when I described the lady, and they shook their heads when I told them about the event. Plus, I knew that my hospital was waiting for me to graduate so I could come to work in the ICU, which was my dream at the time. And it was for a bit more pay than the other hospital was offering anyway. My coworker just pulled off a "Bye, Felicia" to some impatient jerk. We've got limited outside seating and one server to cover the section. When the weather's nice, that server invariably gets slammed because everybody wants to sit out there. Like clockwork, every party that walks through the door was asking to sit outside like a trail of lemmings. We had just quadruple set Wendy, top-tier veteran server, because she can handle it, but decided to put a pause on any further tables for a cool 10 minutes so she could catch up. This older couple walks in and goes, "Party of two, and we're ready to order." "Great," we tell them. "We'll just seat you by the window here." "No, we want to sit outside." "Alright, well, the server is a little behind, so we're putting a pause on any further tables for about 10 minutes, if you don't mind waiting."
"Yeah, okay. Can you at least seat us at that table?"
This should have been the cue to say no, but the host didn't want to deal with them hanging out in the lobby anymore, so went ahead and set them. She reminded them, "Your server, Wendy, is really busy, so hang tight and she'll eventually get to you." Not 2 minutes later, the husband walks in and asks,
"Hey, can anyone at least take our drink order?"
Wendy is standing at the bar collecting drinks within earshot and yells out, "Sir, I'll get to you soon. Please have a seat." He walks over to Wendy.
"Are you the server? 2 gin and tonics, please, and we're ready to order."
"Please have a seat." Wendy comes over to the host's stand to better understand the situation and realizes it's not the host's fault. These people are just jerks. She comes outside to drop the drinks off and takes another table's order. The guy has his finger in the air trying to get her attention. This makes her livid, and she purposefully, passive-aggressively ignores the heck out of them while handling all of the other tables. We call this putting the guest in the penalty box. We're gonna ice you off for 5 minutes until you start behaving like a respectful person. I don't think it had even been the 10 minutes, but Ken and his wife angrily return inside to let the hosts know.
"The service is terrible here. We're leaving."
Wendy sees them leaving and just blurts out, "Bye, Felicia." The couple turned to look, but was none the wiser, and most of the staff around the restaurant just burst out laughing. Be patient with understaffed restaurants, people. Am I the jerk for telling my mom I know she spent my inheritance? Backstory. My 27 female mom, who's 53, has had a really hard life. At age 8, she was adopted into a loving, wealthy family of 2 college professors along with an adopted brother. She had a hard time adjusting, made a lot of bad decisions, and basically ran away in her late teens. In total, she has 5 kids, 4 boys, with me being the middle girl. We grew up very, very poor, with our mother always gone or bringing back strangers to party, leaving me to raise the youngest 2. That being said, I loved my grandparents dearly, and they loved us kids back. And as much as they struggled with my mom, they were nothing but loving towards her from what I understand. My grandparents passed when I was in 5th and 7th grade, and this crushed me. I wasn't able to articulate any of it at the time, but that's when severe depression rolled in. From there on, school was very difficult for me, as well as my home life. I ended up falling pretty deep into my sorrow and stopped going to school around my junior year of high school. After a breakthrough, I decided that I had to get the heck away from that house and ultimately moved out at age 17 to a bigger city about 45 minutes away. I barely finished high school with a 1.75 GPA, and somehow, 2 teachers from the new school convinced me to sign up for the community college. They helped me fill out my FAFSA and everything. I worked full-time, busted my butt, and after 4 years, I finally achieved an AS. I was able to transfer over to a university that I would have never been able to attend right out of high school due to my grades and whatnot, and finish my BS in my favorite field of science. In total, it took me 6 years to get my BS degree, but I worked so hard and I was so proud of what I was able to accomplish. Anyway, I graduated college with $40,000 in student debt. Not so bad compared to most, I always thought. I knew that I would have to work hard and accrue debt to get what I wanted in life, so this was a necessary burden and I've accepted that. However, things have turned in recent events when I reached out to my grandparents' close personal friends, let's call them the Johnsons, to get a better idea of what my grandparents were like. In conversation, it came out that Grandpa left a $150,000 inheritance for his grandkids' education,
However, 3 years later, around 2010, my mother came to the Johnsons and confessed to them that she blew all of the education money. My relationship with her was already strained, but this really crossed a line for me. I emailed her, telling her I know what she did, and told her not to contact me again. The Johnsons quickly got in contact with me, telling me it was a long time ago, and she's improved a lot since then, and that I shouldn't have told her they told me. I think I have the right to confront her, but they say I violated their trust. Am I the jerk? Can't you just make me one now? This just happened this morning at Costco. Our store sells prepared salads, including Caesar, Greek, pasta, etc. This morning we were shopping and witnessed the following. We've got entitled shopper, loudly to herself. Oh, I guess there aren't any Caesar salads. She makes a show of sorting through the other salads as though a sneaky Caesar salad might be hiding underneath the pasta primavera, despite being the size of a truck tire. Karen, again to herself, but clearly for everyone's benefit. I thought they would have Caesar salads. She looks around, craning her head to see into the meat department where a couple of hapless butchers are making sausages. She waves to catch their attention. They nod and continue on with their work. Karen, oh, I guess they're too busy to help a customer. She continues poking at the salads and occasionally looking around to see if anyone is paying attention. She mutters and huffs and sighs deeply. My wife reaches in past her to pick up a Greek salad. Karen tells my wife, don't they make Caesar salads here anymore? Wife, I think so. They were here last time I was here. Karen nods towards the butchers. I guess they're too busy to make them today. Wife shrugs. I don't know. Just then an employee approaches. Karen, excuse me, girl. Yes. Do you have any Caesar salads? I can't find any. Employee. No, sorry, we don't have any today. Well, I need one for my dinner party tonight. Can't you just make one for me now? Employee. No, sorry. I don't believe this. Is there anyone else I can talk to? Employee. Not really, no. This is my area. Why can't they? Nods at the sausage makers. Make me one. Employee. They're not... Of course! I understand they're so busy. Do you think they could stop for a few seconds and put together a simple salad for a customer? Employee. As I was saying, no, they can't. By this point, a small crowd of shoppers is starting to watch. Go, Karen, go. I am very disappointed in the service here. At my store, they believe in customer service. Employee, out of patience. Ma'am, butcher shop employees do not touch the produce due to cross-contamination. Raises voice to talk over her as she starts to raise objections again. We don't have Caesar salads today because we didn't get a shipment of romaine lettuce. I don't appreciate your tone. I want to speak to someone else. Employee, good luck with that. And walked away. Karen stood there in rage as the other shoppers, myself included, laughed and jeered. After a few seconds, she harumphed loudly and pushed her cart off towards the cheese aisle. I lived my server dream, but from the other side of the table. Some background. I'm a server at a high-end Italian restaurant where I've been working for a little over 2 years. My boyfriend and his best friend, who I'll call Buddy, own a home together, and they rent the bottom floor of that home out to a woman who I'll call Drizella. Drizella is a narcissist, total false main character case, and she has gone so far as to make herself a website and Wikipedia page. I usually avoid this woman because if you let her, she'll ramble at you for hours. Last night, boyfriend and I made plans to grab dinner and drinks with Buddy. Drizella overheard us making those plans from a floor away. Is this woman a bat? And said that she'd tag along. Not that we had asked her or anything. We wait for Drizella to ready her bat body. It must require great preparation because we managed to watch 2 whole episodes of Wife Swap whilst we wait. We head downtown, Batwoman tenant in tow, and grab an outdoor table at a favorite cocktail bar of mine. We peruse the menu, and I notice that Drizella's face is twisted up in maybe disgust, maybe confusion, maybe indigestion. I explain some of the cocktails to her and make no headway. A server approaches, and I give her a preemptive, I'm sorry, sort of glance. As I order, Drizella interrupts me and says, what is up with this menu? Don't you have anything normal? The server directs her to the first cocktail, as I, too, had done. It's a basic margarita, but with the addition of a house-made syrup. That sounds weird. Drizella hems and haws.
Do you have anything like a gin and tonic?
The server enthusiastically points out their house spin on gin and tonic, as I too had done.
That sounds awful.
Server points out a few other of the more basic cocktails, understanding with every suggestion that this isn't about appeasing a guest, but more about being toyed with by a woman who is part bat, part menace. We wait, all of us, as Drizella proceeds to ask about at least 80% of the cocktail menu.
I'll take this cocktail. That's nothing like anything I'd asked about or hinted towards wanting.
Server leaves, and Drizella asks why the server couldn't have suggested the cocktail she ended up ordering. I whip my face towards her and say,
you shot down everything he suggested, all while proving no helpful feedback about what you wanted.
Usually when that happens to me at work, I leave the guests to read the menu. She interrupts me a number of times as I'm saying this, so I repeat it once more, but much more loudly this time. Buddy snickers, boyfriend cackles, Drizella pouts. As we wait for our drinks, Drizella starts shivering dramatically, as 75 degrees is practically an icy tundra. She grabs for the outdoor heater, and I swat her hand away. Every time a member of the service staff passes near our table, Drizella loudly remarks about how long our craft cocktails are taking. On this very busy night, where the servers clearly have 9 table or more sections, and there's only one bartender to service this bustling establishment. Drinks arrive, and Drizella complains that her cocktail has too much ice.
How am I even supposed to see how much alcohol is in there?
She frowns the entire time her drink is in hand. I grab the check as soon as it's dropped, leave 30%, and apologize to our server on the way out. We head to another restaurant for dinner, and the host says it'll be around 20 minutes for a table. Drizella, now full of alcohol and something that probably feels like bravery, but is actually jerkness, walks up to a nearby table and half asks, half spits,
why can't we sit here?
It's very clearly a service station. We wait for 10 minutes, all the while Drizella pouts and whines. She says something about going up to stare at the hostess, and that's where I draw the line.
You won't be doing that, because that's rude.
It seems like maybe you're better off making your own meal tonight. She quietly agrees, and I drive her home. Boyfriend and I return to the restaurant, where we have a lovely dinner and both agree that we will not attempt to dine out with Drizella again. I'm still riding that sweet, sweet high of finally being able to tell a jerk customer to buzz off. You can eat at the hotel. A long, long time ago, in the late 90s, when I was a young IT consultant, I was sent out of state on an assignment. The sales manager decided to make all of the travel arrangements for me and my coworker. We were to stay at a Holiday Inn type hotel that he booked for us. When I asked about daily expenses and a rental car, the sales manager told me that the hotel had a shuttle that would take us to worksite and we could eat at the hotel restaurant. I tried to argue with him that I'd like to see the town or eat somewhere other than the hotel, but he wouldn't budge. He paid for the flights and the rooms, and we would charge our meals to our room. Anything else would be paid for out of our own pockets. I was young and broke, so I didn't have much of a choice. I settled into the expectation that I would have a boring week of hotel/work/hotel for 5 days. When my coworker and I arrived at the hotel, we were quite surprised to find that it wasn't at all a Holiday Inn type hotel, in spite of the fact that it had Inn in the name. It was quite fancy, and the rooms were comfortable and spacious. The hotel restaurant, though, was something my lower middle class self had never experienced. This was a restaurant that didn't print prices on the menu. In fact, I couldn't even pronounce half of the items listed. Meals were a set cost regardless of what you ordered. Breakfast was $40 per person. Lunches and dinners were $60 per person. Knowing we had no car and no way to expense anything that wasn't charged to the room, my coworker and I dutifully ate 3 meals a day in the hotel restaurant. I had 5 days of filet mignon for breakfast, and various gourmet lunches and dinners, while the hotel shuttle took us to and from the workplace all week. Now, years later, I'm not even sure I remember the city I was in or the work I was doing, but I remember a week of filet mignon for breakfast and the look in the eyes of the sales manager when he saw his credit card statement. That was a great trip.
Am I the jerk for asking my husband not to bring his friend around? I'm 43, female, and my husband, who's 45, has a friend, Todd, who's 39, that he's been hanging out with since we moved to our new state for work 5 years ago. When we first moved here, I struggled to find a new job. Todd would make passive-aggressive comments about how nice it must be to have someone support me. When I told my husband about it, he told me that Todd was joking and didn't mean it. I told him that it offended me and that I didn't find it funny, and he told me that I was taking it out of context. Since then, Todd has made more offensive comments. Last month, when I brought my husband a coffee and some food to his work, he was working overtime and he was tired and hungry. Todd saw me in the parking lot and remarked about how nice it must be to have a wife that brings coffee and food on command. I told him that I was not a dog and do not talk to me like that. The next day, when he saw my husband, he told him about the conversation we had in the parking lot and said that I was rude to him for no reason. So I told my husband what he said, and I told him that I will not be spoken to like that. My husband told me that I need to relax and that he didn't mean to be rude. Last week was the last straw. I replaced my phone after 7 years of having it. I had been saving money for 6 months to pay straight cash for the new phone. Unbeknownst to me, my husband had ordered it for me as a surprise. I was so excited and happy to finally have a phone that worked right. The night that I got it, we went out to dinner and ran into Todd while we were waiting for a table. Apparently, he knew that my husband was getting me a new phone and even remarked how spoiled I was and how hard my husband works for me to just spend his money. I saw red. I told him that first of all, I didn't spend his money. He did. That I have a job and I'm more than capable of buying my own phone, and that he was a petty, jealous jerk who was angry because he can't find a girlfriend who will put up with his crap. So he takes it out on me because I'm the only woman who will speak to him. We ended up just going home, and my husband gave me the silent treatment the whole ride home. As soon as we walked into the door, he told me that I embarrassed him. I told him that I was embarrassed when his friend told me that I was some kind of money-grubbing leech, and he just stood there and allowed it to happen. I told him that I do not want Todd around anymore and that he wasn't welcome in the house. My husband thinks I'm overreacting, and that's just how Todd is.
Click this button to join as a member and we'll give you a shout out in our next video.
And come watch this video next. You won't believe what Karen did in that one.